He's one of the greatest contemporary musicians of the era, acknowledged the world over as a musical genius, a cult figure, an icon. I adore his music, and I'm thrilled to have a special rendezvous with God's gifted child, A.R Rahman.
Just let your thoughts, your dreams unfold. Let's talk of love, of tales untold. Speak so I can see your soul. Speak so I can see your soul.
A.R Rahman, this is an occasion, and I'm so thrilled to have you here.
Me too, because I've been watching your show for past 2 years and was thinking, will I be there? So I'm here.
And you've flown in specially for my show. Thank you so much.
No problem.
These are very exciting times for you. Have your feet touched the ground in the last past year?
Yes, of course, because I spent a whole month fasting in Madras, my base, so that kind of brought me down to earth, and here am I.
You have Bobby Dreams running at the West End, heading for Broadway. Mm-hmm. Was this ever a fantasy of yours?
No, it's not been a dream because I never thought I was eligible to be a West End stage composer. I never thought that kind of thing will enter my life.
When Lord Andrew Lloyd Webber approached you and said, will you write a musical for my stage? What did you say? What did you feel?
The first thing which came to my mind was whether it was true or not.
Yeah.
Because Shaker first called me and said, I want you to speak to Andrew Lloyd Webber. I said hi to him and he said, he loved my music. I said, what music did you listen to? He said, all your Bollywood songs, which we have a collection and we want to make it as a musical. Mm. I said, no, I don't want the old stuff. I would like to do something new. So he said, yeah, okay, let's talk about it. And when I went to London, when I met him, I knew how much in love he was with all the songs and stuff.
Absolutely. And for the first time, as a composer himself, he produces somebody else's work.
Yeah, that's amazing, actually. That was very, you need a great amount of secure mind to do that kind of stuff, to produce somebody else's and still not interfere in the creative input and encourage them to.
He says, so convinced was he of your talent that he invested £4.5 million on you.
Huge burden on my head.
But you had seen a lot of Webber's work before? You were familiar with his music?
I was familiar with The Phantom of the Opera. I couldn't understand it that time. Okay. That was around probably 18 years back.
Okay.
I'd seen Evita in 99, the movie.
Yeah.
So that was amazing.
So 3 years and 20 compositions later, Mommy Dreams opens at Apollo Theatre.
In a trance going out of my mind, you made a flame that keeps me burning. Come on baby, give me a sign. Wonder from you and the world stops turning.
I couldn't make it for the opening night, if you remember. But you tell me, how did it go? Were you tense?
Not very much, because when you are in safe hands, like Andrew's company, they know what they do. They're professionals, and for the first time, I was less burdened. I didn't have the physical role. It was more a creative role.
But was he more tense or you?
All of us were at the back. We had this little, would it work or not? Will it work or not? And then I had to trust in God, and Andrew had to trust in his people. So it did work for me.
At the end, when they gave you a standing ovation, how many minutes? I think 13 minutes.
13 minutes, right. 20 seconds. I'm not very sure about that.
When you were taking your bows, what was going on in your heart?
When something happens in a positive manner in a life, whether it's a successful thing or whether it's an appreciation, I usually say this word, Alhamdulillah, which means all praise to God. And I kind of take that burden off my head. So that's what I did. And of course, I was so moved that Andrew, in front of all this Western press, kind of hugged me and said, I'm really proud of you. And he said, you have to take the torch of Western theatre forward, and you young people should come forward to do more musicals. And this when I thought, you know, how life destiny dictates you more than what you crave for. Like, it came from his mouth, and I never thought he would say that.
It's the ultimate compliment.
Yeah, I'm grateful for that. Being such a successful and extraordinary composer himself, coming forward and doing something which is completely unknown to him, and trusting that, getting all the people, even the Queen, saying to her that this is my composer and he's done this musical, and that was really moving.
So you met the Queen as well?
Yeah.
How was that meeting?
Being a very conservative person herself, I think she was quite taken aback when she saw this Bombay Dreams thing, a very Asian thing. Mm. I could see that little thing in her eyes, but she was very appreciative about the work and the cast and all this stuff.
What did she say to you?
She said something which I couldn't remember.
You can't remember?
Yeah. I think she said a very energetic show or something like that.
Very energetic show. But it's really strange that you can't remember it, because a lot of people...
Because I'm more concerned about what should I do when the Queen comes. Should I shake her hand or I say take a bow, you know?
Yeah.
A very confusing thing.
So what did you do?
We shook hands.
And you didn't?
No, I just shook hands. So, looking at me.
And was Prince Philip there too?
No.
Just the Queen?
I met Prince Charles 2 months back.
Okay.
In a party. It was the richest Asian show or something like that. Mm. That's when I got introduced to Prince Charles.
See, I mean, where life takes you. I mean, you meet all these amazing people. The
I know.
You know, you have gone where no Indian has gone before. You've made that leap from Chennai to Broadway. In this whirlwind that is surrounding you, does the Asian Mozart ever pause and look back at the journey where he's come from?
The moment you just stand and look back, it kind of halts you.
Do you remember clearly that young boy from Chennai, mm-hmm. who grew up a little before his time?
Yes, I do remember. When I look back at where I started, I think destiny and God has played a major factor in my life.
You were Dilip Shekhar at that time.
Yeah.
What was Dilip like?
Almost similar.
Almost similar.
But more complex.
You were brought up with three sisters.
Yeah.
Your father was a music composer and an arranger.
Yeah.
He brought the first synth out to India.
Yeah.
So that was...
In fact, he got a free ticket to Japan. Got the first Korg SH-700 or something like that.
So that was your first introduction to...
Yeah, synthesizers. I remember him tweaking, at the age of 5, I think. I remember him tweaking all the sounds, trying to simulate frog and night effects and stuff.
And you must have been fascinated.
Yeah.
So you learned music from him at a young age.
He did teach me the basics. And then when I was 4, I remember accompanying my father to the studios. Then he fell ill when I was almost like 5 or 6. My whole 5 to 9 year old, that age was in the hospitals with him.
Yes,
in the Cancer Institute and, you know, all kinds of spiritual healing and all this stuff.
Must have been a lot of anxiety.
I didn't know much because it was life for me. That was the exposure of life for me at that stage. Maybe I thought maybe this is what destiny was that time. when somebody reads about certain thing and when they go to a playground, they think, okay, this is life, this is enjoyment. When I go to hospital, then I think,
this
is my life. So,
and this is
in a way, actually, all those things have tamed me up. Maybe I would have become I wouldn't have become a musician if all those things had not happened. And my music wouldn't have that part of melancholy felt that was life, because that's what I had.
You've said that it's very important, apart from knowing the ragas and everything, it's very important for that little bit of sorrow.
Yeah, I think it kind of brings a melody into your life. It's the same thing, actually, when you fast during Ramadan, we see the hunger of the poor man sitting on the road. Because when you're always filled, you have a filled stomach always, then you don't realize the hunger and you think that it's all cool. So it's almost like that.
But when your father was very ill, did you realize what was happening? Did you understand what's going on?
It's a complex thing, because at that time, though I don't believe in all this black magic and all this stuff, every one of my father's friends, they would say, oh, they've done this to him, they've done to Shekhar, you know? Mm. It's still a mystery for me.
Your mystery, what happened to him?
Yeah, you always kind of expect, okay, now after this, he's going to become all right. After this, he's going to become, you kind of expect that kind of thing. And then suddenly he became all right, almost.
He did all become all right.
And 1 week later, he died.
Oh.
Yeah, it was almost as, it seemed as though it was gaining a kind of, it's getting healed or something like that. That was very funny.
But your mother must have gone through a terrible time.
Yeah. With all 4 children with her and stuff like that. It was more like a struggle and family circumstances and all the stuff. Trouble.
So as the only male in the family, you went out to work?
I did this job called roadie. Roadie means you take the instruments and set up for other people. So that happened for 3-4 years, from the age of 10 to 13, 14. Mm. Then my mother felt that I should start playing to be a permanent keyboard player, which would give sufficient money for the family to run.
Yeah. You took on the responsibility.
Actually, my mother had taken quite a lot of responsibility, and we just had our bit of it, my sisters and myself. And
having to earn at the age of 10, looking after family, having responsibilities, burdens, what does it do to a young boy?
I think it kind of shapes you up to be a nice boy. When I have look back at my life now, it seems as though it's a big thing. But at that time, it's part of life, and then you swim across, and then you cross that. Mm. Understand? So when you start away with a rough kind of beginning, then you cope with it.
Mm. But what about school?
School, I was a very bad student. Students said I skipped school, so.
Obviously, if you're working,
you
can't
get abuses from school quite often. I did my 10th, and then I did a couple of months on the plus one, and then I left halfway.
Because you had to work?
Yeah, lack of attendance and stuff like that.
But the teachers must have been very angry.
In fact, the famous abuses, take your son and go to the platform of the streets of Kodambakkam, then they'll put your money. Don't bring him to school.
They said that?
Naturally, when you don't go to school, they have to do that. When I just think about it now, they were right, and they had to be strict and stuff like that.
But is it true that they used to even whack you with a ruler?
Again, lack of attendance, mostly.
And what did you say?
I mean, what was supposed to be fun became a kind of serious thing.
Did you talk to your mother? Did you tell her what you were going through? Or no, you didn't?
We had enough problems, I mean, on the whole family. And so, I mean, I could see what was happening. So I had to take care of this side by myself. Mm. Of course, we had my sisters were there supporting all of us, and mentally and emotionally.
Were you ever a carefree child?
No, not then. Too many questions about the future, what would happen, and things like that. And bothered about our family with just my mother and my 3 sisters.
Did it toughen you, or did it make you introverted?
Mm. It's a complex answer, actually. Yes, I had these complexes about myself.
What?
Because of all this thing at school and about being without a father and being in music. And being in music was not cool that time. Yeah, it's like, okay, you're a musician and what we respect is government jobs, you know, that kind of thing. And you have to cross all that and believe in yourself and work hard. But one thing which was good about him was after he died, when I went playing for sessions, everyone had a very good opinion about him. And they would say, because of your father, I'm here. Because of your father, I'm a musician. Because of him, I've got this house. Because he used to use me in all the sessions. And
okay.
So I felt good that, you know, was born to a very nice person rather than, and a musician.
But you must have grown up before your time.
In a way, actually, I feel younger now than what I felt that those days.
Actually, you are going through your...
Yeah, that, exactly.
That
so
now.
Reverse is happening.
It's an interesting thing.
In fact, just before Roja, I met all this young band and I started playing in them. Then I realized that I was a young person and I could play young music than just playing background for those weeping mothers. And because at age 23, I was like mixing with a 60-year-old and 50-year-old, very sweet people. And I thought I was one among them. And then it took me probably a year and a half to realize that I was young and I could go further in my own way.
But you don't have gray hair.
Yeah. I mean, you have to look at life. You can't just keep complaining all your life. You have to see what you can learn from, you know, because everything says something. What I got from them is values and stuff like that, about music and about ethics and stuff, and what not to learn from them.
Yeah.
Musicians also have this other side, sense of complacency which they have. Okay, this is our life, this is our music, and it's forbidden to go beyond this. Mm. I think I wanted to go further than that, and every time you push yourself and do something, people always say, don't do that, it's a waste of time.
I know.
But it's you can't take it like that. You can't have to make it as a stepping stone for you.
Did you believe in yourself?
Did
you know you had the talent?
No.
You did not know?
I thought I was a mediocre.
Don't be silly.
Really. Until I did Roja. When I started composing, that's when I felt that this is not mine. So that's when I started believing that I'm not this. There's something else coming here. And
a new force.
Yeah. Because when you listen to my music pre-Roja or anything, even my playing, it's completely
different.
Which
was the first song you recorded?
The first song was Chodi Si Aasha.
It was a lovely song.
Yeah, isn't it?
But you created a completely new sound and beat and rhythm.
But it took a lot of time. I didn't know what people would expect or anything. So we just went by instinct, which was Rangila actually, which is the first original Hindi score.
And you became a phenomenon.
I think Taal kind of made it a standard. Because still before then it was, okay, the guy from South has done something.
Let's something new, yeah.
Yeah. I'm quite grateful to Subhash guy for that.
Have you ever watched the young generation dancing to your numbers at discos?
Never been to a disco much.
You never been to a disco?
Just once or twice when it was empty.
Initially you were very shy and you didn't sing your own songs.
Because when I sing, imagine what they think. You first sing in tune and then you tell us to sing in tune.
No. you sing with so much passion.
Okay.
I mean, Vande Mataram, nobody else can sing it like you. I feel there's a direct connection from your vocal cord to your heart the way it comes out.
Bala pushed me through that. I remember when I first did the track, 1 o'clock I called Bala, night. And then he came over and there's no sound engineer. My sound engineer had left. So I told him, just press the record button and the play button. And then we'll roll. And when I came out, he was crying. I thought, what? Did I sing wrong? No, it was fantastic.
It was like a new national anthem.
I think the main thing was to do something very young and take the essence of it and then really make people feel, and first feel within ourselves. So the first thing which came was Matuje Salam. First performance was in Delhi. I think I would feel the pulse of the whole people. I went to the US for concerts.
Mm.
Seeing Indian audiences react to that so much. Almost getting up and, you know, as a mark of respect, I could see the real joy of people, all communities.
I think it's one of the greatest compositions ever.
Thank you.
But tell me, what gives you joy?
When you're doing music, I think you kind of immerse yourself and then joy or sorrow gets lost within it when you're in that particular zone when music happens. And I think mostly what joy is for me is a reflection of seeing it on other people.
That's what I wondered.
Yeah.
Is it the reaction?
Yeah, it's a reaction.
Or is it the creation?
I think you can remember the reaction better than the... It gets lost somewhere when you're doing it.
Does appreciation count a lot with you?
It does count when you don't get it.
Oh, come on.
That's when you find the worth of it.
So tell me, where do you want to go? Where do you want to reach?
I never think about that.
You don't.
Things are quite unpredictable in life.
That's true.
I would rather say that I'm like a boat on a river without a sail. And I'm taking the course of the river, going to the destination. And when I reach the destination, I know that, okay, I've come here.
And it goes wherever the breeze of God takes it.
Yeah.
But tell me something, has your success healed the insecurities of your childhood?
In fact, more than what I deserved. That's what I feel when I look back.
Mm. So do any fears remain?
I think the worst fear is about... Not about my own death, it's about other people whom you like. That's the worst fear when you think about, you can't get over it.
You must feel this because you lost your father.
Yeah. And every person, every human being has this fear. When I meet God, how will I face Him? Sometimes when you do good things in life, you feel good that maybe I have a chance. Mm.
A.R., you were born Dilip Kumar Shekhar. And I think soon after your father died, your mother converted to Islam.
No, it's not a conversion kind of thing. It was more like a spiritual journey.
Right.
They were more affected by Sufism.
Yeah.
And this piece of Karimullah Shahkazri. It's not like one Sunday I woke up and... So this journey kind of led us somewhere, the whole family. And then we could feel that we're going on to something which was healing all our pains.
Because you went through a lot of pain at that
yeah.
time.
Not only me, I think the whole family.
Yeah.
And somewhere Sufism and music, they go very complement each other. And you could feel certain things happening, certain incidents which happened in our family, leading through that whole journey. And for me as a person, being a musician, you always ask questions within yourself. The whole process of creation and birth and where each person goes and the celestial and the universe and all this stuff raises questions within yourself. And then you kind of crave for an answer. And then I started believing this oneness of God.
But there was a stage when you were a teenager when you doubted if there was a God.
Yeah, everybody goes through that phase. Eh? There's certain unexplainable things which happen in your life. You can only associate it with the magic of God.
So when did Dilip Shekhar become A.R. Rahman?
From 89, slowly. And then my mother asked Maniratnam that, can I change my son's name as this? Because I thought I should have a new identity which should give me more confidence. And
so who chose the name for you?
My mother chose it for me.
What a lovely name.
Yeah.
Did you find, when you became A.R. Rahman, any change in you as a person?
Probably 6 months after the name was changed, I bought a book, which was The 99 Names of Allah. Then I opened the book, and the first name was A.R. Rahman. And that kind of gave me a shock. Having this name, I should respect it and elevate it rather than, you know, go against. So it kind of burden on my head.
You said somewhere that it was like having taken a dip in a sea. So cleansed did you feel? You washed away the old pain and...
Yeah, exactly. To get an identity where I don't have to remember all my failures. And as I was being born again. So it kind of helped me a great deal. Thinking that, okay, this person is fresh and he only does this. He doesn't do that.
Okay, start fresh.
Start fresh.
Okay. Your first salary was 50 rupees.
50 rupees. To operate a record player.
And now you're accounted amongst the top 10 Asian
exaggerated
earners.
Amount.
Asian earners in Britain. And you've made about £2 million in the last year or so. I'm delighted about it. But how does it feel?
Money actually is a burden for a creative person. Because the moment I have 20,000 rupees in my hand, I always think about how to spend it.
How should I spend it?
Should I do this? Then finally when I give it off, I feel much more happier than having it within me. In every religion it says that don't own anything. You just have this little thin membrane of separation.
Between you and the world?
Between you, yourself and money, between yourself and fame, between yourself and family, which is more most difficult one. So when you lose something, you don't lose it all because you'd never owned it. And like money, fame or whatever.
Yeah. Would you be scared of losing the fame that you have if everything disappeared?
It came from him and it's gone to him. Rather than brooding about it, we should just thank for what you had. And sometimes when one door closes, 7 doors open.
It happened with you.
It does happen if you believe it.
You got married in 95. How come you opted for an arranged marriage?
To be honest, I didn't have the time to go and search for a bride. I was doing all those films and Rangila and Bombay and all that stuff. So busy in that. But I knew that it was the right time for me to get married. I was 29. Mm-hmm. And told my mother, I said, find a bride.
Did you have any specifications?
I said a simple one. Who won't give me much trouble. So I could carry on doing my music and hope she inspires me to do more music.
You've forgotten what you said. You told your mother, I want a bride with some education, some beauty, and loads of humility.
Yeah.
So where did you find her?
I think my mother found her sister near a Sufi shrine. And then that led to my wife, Saira.
So then you met Saira for the first time?
Yeah.
How was it?
It's funny.
Why funny?
Because till then I'd never had the intention. I mean, like, seeing a girl with that kind of look. Yeah. So it was funny first. So I asked her whether you'd be interested in marrying me and do you have anything else in mind. So she said yes. And
but she was an A.R. Rahman fan, come on.
But I had to give her an opportunity to talk, right? Yeah, she said she liked one of my songs and she told about that and stuff.
This was done over tea, the usual way like you see in Hindi films.
Yeah, more simpler.
How is it?
Not with music.
And tell me, what's Sarah like?
She is calm when she's calm, and she gets angry, she's angry. There are two sides of her. Initially, she used to get frustrated. I mean, not going out. I mean, generally, you can't go out for shopping, or, you know.
No. So it must have been a lot of adjustment for her to get married to somebody.
I did tell her in the beginning what kind of life she's going to lead.
You did tell her?
It's an agreement before.
You're going to bring her over to see me on Rendezvous?
Hopefully.
Love to have you both over here together. You. Now you have two daughters, Khadija and Rahima. Do you spend enough time with them?
I do, actually. Though they don't, they kind of shy away sometimes. The elder one kind of insists that I should tell her stories. So I try to make up some stories for her.
How do they feel about their father being such a famous guy?
My elder daughter kind of blushes when somebody asks her, who is your father? What does he do? Mm. So she knows, I think, basically, Khadija. And she says, don't come to school because people will trouble you for autographs. Yeah. I think the younger one is slowly getting the hang of it.
What do you want to teach them?
Very difficult question these days, I think. What I want them to be is Islamic and secular. And to have loads of knowledge about the world, to become very important persons in tomorrow, God willing.
What does your mother feel about your success? More than anyone, she must be so happy.
They're all a very important part of my success, actually. My whole family, my sisters and my mother. Because when something big happens, they kind of pray for it. And you could see the tension in them. It's not that, okay, it's achieved. And even today, if there's something important, you could see them all. And they would kind of encourage me, don't worry, we're praying for you. And this is going to happen. And that's what you need as a family, to share all the kind of highs and lows. I'm grateful to them for that.
Thank you.
It's overture from Bombay Teams.
It's beautiful. Play me five of your favorite compositions.
This is one of them, Bombay Teams.
Okay.
And another one. It's one of the recent favorites. And another one. This was from Roja.
But they didn't have this in Hindi version.
They did have, but I don't have the lyrics.
Okay, alright. Any other?
Let me think. Same Vande Mataram, I guess.
Okay. Tell me, is there any song from any other composer that you wish you had composed?
There's so many, actually. But one of my favorites of Andrew Lloyd Webber was Don't Cry for Me, Argentina.
Oh, let's hear that. Any other Indian composer song that you wish you had composed, or some favorite from your old?
I like the song. I don't know who composed it. Yemen composition so beautifully, you know? That's one of that. There's so many, actually, so many geniuses in India. If I start doing that, you need to give me 5 episodes, I think.
Cyrus' favorite, your wife's favorite.
There's one happy one and the sad one. I'll probably play you the sad one.
Okay. Thank you. matching.
Yeah.
And your mother?
My mother... she's never told me what she likes in my stuff. She's more critical of my work than...
She really...
It's good.
What? Dedicate one song to her.
Okay. Matu Jai Salam.
Perfect. True for me to have you sing the song in front of
me. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It's so beautiful. You know, this is my favorite song. Out of all the songs in the world, this is my favorite. But I want to ask you one thing. If God were to say to you, A.R. Rahman, I gave you a great gift. What did you do on earth that justified the gift I gave to you? Would you sing him Vande Mataram?
Anything which brings peace in this world, especially nowadays. Music needs to heal a lot of people. Yeah. It needs to have a good vibe with all of them, and it becomes like a zikr, which you say, like an incantation. And when that's heard by all the world, that does something spiritually. There was this song which I did for Mani Ratnam's movie, which happened during the Sri Lankan turmoil.
Yes.
And this was about the peace for those people. And in just 2 weeks later, I just heard from the new election happened and there was peace there, which really brought joy to me. Okay, I'll say that.
I don't want this rendezvous to end. I could sit here the whole night just listening to you.
You would have to stand for the next one. So must every Indian.
Janagana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya Bharata Bhagya Vidha Panjaba Sundara Gujarat. jaya.